وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're in the biography of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and we were previously speaking about the Bina'ul Ka'bah, the building of the Kaaba, and the role that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam played in that. We reached a point where Abu Umayyah ibn al-Mughira al-Makhzumi, he said, who was the father of Umm al-Mu'minina, Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and he was the oldest man, as we said, asannu rajulin fi Quraysh, he was the oldest man in Quraysh. He suggested an idea when they disputed about the placing of the black stone. So what he said was, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, O Quraysh, ij'alu baynakum fima takhtalifuna fihi. This dispute can be settled easily, he said. Place it in the hand, the solution is in the hand of the first person who enters from that door. Anybody who enters from that door, فَرَضُوا, accept his judgment, وَقَبِلُوهُ, take into consideration, all of you. Do you agree? So it could be anybody, it could be anybody from Quraysh. So it's not on any particular tribe's side. So if somebody randomly walks in, and it turns out to be any of the tribe's member, they won't reject it because it wasn't planned out. So this is where we stopped. And who was that person who came through the door? So everybody started to gaze towards the door. فَأَشْخَصُوا أَبْصَارَهُمْ, they started to fully analyze and look at towards that door. وَشْرَأَبَّتِ الْعَنَاقِ, those who were short were stretching out their necks to see who's going to come through that door. Who can this person be? As they were looking, فَإِذَا بِهِ الصَّادِقُ الْأَمِينَ, the truthful one, the reliable one, Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked through that door. When everybody saw the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and they laid eyes on him, and they realized that he was the one who came through, Quraysh, not one of them showed any hostility or rejection towards what Nabiullah Muhammad is going to say. Each person, when they saw him, they said, هذا الأمين, this is the truthful one, رضينا, we are pleased, هذا محمد, this is who, محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, we're pleased with the judgment that he passes. So the Prophet doesn't know. He walks in and he just sees the people saying this. So they went over to him عليه الصلاة والسلام, أخبروه الخبر, they told him about the news. When they told him about the problem that happened and what took place and the news, time didn't go by. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was wise, very smart. Sahibul aql nafis, he had a very amazing mind, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said to them, halumma ilayya thawban, bring me a garment, a big garment. So they brought him a garment. Fa'utiya bihi, when they gave him the garment, فَأَخَذَ الْحَجَرَ الْأَسْوَدِ, the Prophet took the black stone. فَوَضَعَهُ فِيهِ, he placed it in the garment. When they brought it to him, he took it and he placed it in the garment. ثُمَّ قَالَ, he then said to them, لِتَأْخُذُ كُلَّ قَبِيلَةٍ, every single tribe from amongst you, let him grab بِنَاحِيَةِ مِنَ الثَّوْبِ, each person take a representative from you, each tribe, let a person from amongst you grab it. ثُمَّ رَفَعُوهُ جَمِيعًا, all of you then lift it from the ground. The stone is in the middle, the cloth is, everybody's holding it from the side, all of you lift it at one time. So everyone's playing a role now, صح? All of you lifted. They all lifted it up until they reached mawdi'ahu, the place that the stone needs to be put in. Then the Prophet ﷺ took it with his own hands, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he placed it inside its place. He put it in, alayhi salatu wasalam. And this was what prevented a great destruction that could have come to the Arabs. They were fighting. They were going to fight over who's going to place that stone in the place. The Prophet saved, alayhi salatu wasalam, blood. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And the war could have been torn between the custodians of the Kaaba. And this Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose it, a wisdom. It was a wisdom Allah tabarak wa ta'ala willed and intended, which there's no wisdom greater than it, that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose. Quraysh, building the Kaaba, they made it a decision. What was the decision that Quraysh made? That they're going to build the Kaaba with what? An-nafaqat al-halal, halal income. Every single tribe has to bring halal income. And that the money that's going to be built with the Kaaba can't be any money that's haram. So that shows you that they knew that what has to be observed in building this house, it has to be halal. They knew that. So what did they do? They brought all the money that they had. So what happened? The money finished. The money that was halal finished quickly. Haram is always more. Like if you ask a person today, ya akhi, bring the money from your money that's halal, kathiru minna, they can't. Where is it? Yeah? Or even if you did, it might be 200-300 from 10,000 that you have maybe. That's problematic. So Quraysh, they tried it and they put all the effort in making sure that the money they bring is halal. So it finished from them. And the Kaaba still needs to be built. There's part of the Kaaba that needs to be finished off. They weren't able to finish it off. And the angle that stopped was Jihatu Shimaliyah, the left side of the Kaaba, which today is called the Hijr. Hijr of Nabila Ismail. That part of the Kaaba, they couldn't build. So the Kaaba is actually longer than that. It's meant to be longer than that. So the nafaqah finished. So what they did was, they made that wall around the Kaaba to say that this is part of the Kaaba. So that little wall they built. Because you're not allowed to do tawaf around that part. Because that's inside the Kaaba. You have to do it around the Kaaba, right? The person is not allowed. And the reason why they did that wall was to inform the people that this is what? Min al-bayti, that is from the house. And this is what is known as today as the Hijri. It's known as the Hijr. And Imam al-Nawi says in Sharah of Sahih Muslim, he says, وَهُوَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. The Hijr is part of the house. وَلِذَلِكَ لَا يَصِحُ الطَّوَافُ إِلَّا مِنْ وَرَائِهِ. And because of that, the tawaf is not permitted except around it. The tawaf is what? It's allowed what? Around the Kaaba. وَسُمِّيَ بِذَلِكَ لِأَنَّهُ حُجِرًا أي اقتطع من الكعبة. The reason why it was called a hijr is because it's broken off from the Kaaba. It's not part of the Kaaba. It's part of the Kaaba, so it's a broken part of the Kaaba. That's why it's called hijr. The Arabs, they say حجر يعني اقتطع من الكعبة. It was broken from the Kaaba. The length of the Kaaba, at the time of Ibrahim and Ismail, it was 9 adru'in. It was 9 arm span. Oh, that's how long it was. 9 times. That's how long the Kaaba was. At the time of who? Ibrahim and Ismail, alayhim as-salam. And he used to have 2 doors at the time of Ibrahim and Ismail. A door was Bab Sharqi. One was on the east and one was on the west. And Gharbi. The reason why they had 2 doors is that one door you would enter into it and the other door you would come out of it. So one door was for the people to come in and another door was for the people to what? Come out. But when Quraysh built it, what they did was is زَادُوا فِي إِرْتِفَاعِهَا. When Quraysh came, they added on 9 other an arm span onto it. The nine that Nabiullah Ibrahim and Ismail built, they added extra nine onto that. And as for the door, وَاقْتَصَرُوا عَلَى بَابٍ وَاحِدٍ. As for the door, they took away the other one and they only left one door. And with that door, what did they do? وَرَفَعُوا بَابَهَا. They lifted that door from the floor, from the earth. They made it in the middle of the Kaaba. And anybody who would want to enter it, لَا يُصْعَدُ إِلَيْهَا إِلَّا عَنْ سُلَّمٍ. The person won't be able to enter the Kaaba unless he has a ladder. The reason why they did that is لِيُدْخِلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, so they can bring in whoever they wanted. وَيَمْنَعُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, and they can stop whoever they wanted. So they made the door high. You can't come. It's too high for you to come up. So you need a ladder to be able to what? To come up. And it's still the same today. It's just that it has a stairs that you go onto it. But it's still high today. And it's just got that one door as well. Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. من حديث عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said يا عائشة أو عائشة لولا أن قومك أو عائشة if your people were not حديث عهد بجاهلية أو عائشة if your people were not new reverts who just come into Islam who just came from disbelief لَأَمَرْتُ بِالْبَيْتِ فَهُدِمَا I would have commanded for the Kaaba to be broken and demolished and I would build it again فَأَدْخَلْتُ فِيهِ مَا أُخْرِجَ مِنْهُ and I would bring back what was taken from it. Everything that was, such as I'll bring back the two doors, okay? I would make it shorter by bringing it nine as Ibrahim and Ismail built it. I'll do that. وجعلت له بابين بابا شرقيا وبابا غربيا فبلغت به أساس إبراهيم. I would make it according to the foundation of Ibrahim. The nine أذرع Ibrahim did, I would do that, he said. In another wording, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated in حديث عائشة that he said, سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الجدري. Aisha said, I asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about the جدري. The جدري here means the حجر إسماعيل. I asked him about it. Aisha is saying this. أمين البيت هو. Is the Hijr part of the Bayt Kaaba? Is this part of the Kaaba? قَالَ نَعَمْ The Prophet said, Aisha, yes, it is from part of the Kaaba. قُلْتُ فَلِمَ لَمْ يُدْخِلُوهُ فِي الْبَيْتِ Why did they not put that part, why did they not add it into the Kaaba? قَالَ The Prophet said, إِنَّ قَوْمَكِ Aisha, your people, قَصُرَتْ بِهِمُ النَّفَقَةِ The provision, it reduced from them. They couldn't bring more money to the table. قلت فما شأن بابه مرتفعا and then why is the door high Aisha said why is the door very high قال he then said to her فعل ذلك قومك Aisha your people did this ليدخله من شاء so they can bring in whoever they will ويمنع من شاء and they can stop whoever they want ولولا if only أن قومك if your people حديث أحدهم بالجاهلية if these people were not new to Islam recently coming to Islam فأخاف أن تنكر قلوبهم and I was not scared that their heart will reject this what would I have done أن أدخل الجدر في البيت I would have taken the Kaaba and built it and add the Hijr part of the Kaaba I would have rebuilt it like that وأن ألصق بابه بالأرض and I would have made the door stick to the earth the door not make it high like it is. This hadith, Ibn Hajar rahimahullah in Fathul Bari, he extracts six benefits from it. Inshallah ta'ala, we're going to take those six benefits. Hafiz Ibn Hajar in Fathul Bari, he extracts benefits from this incident between Aisha and the Prophet when they were talking about this issue. The first is, اجتناب ولي الأمر ما يتسرع الناس إلى إنكاره وما يخشى منه تولد الضرر عليهم في دين أو دنيا. He said, the leader should abstain that which the people will hasten to reject. The leader should abstain and stay away from doing something that the people will hasten to what? Rejecting it from him. They won't take it from him. Okay? وَمَا يَخْشَى مِنْهُ تَوَلُّدُ الطَّرَرِ عَلَيْهِمْ فِي دِينٍ أَوْ دُنْيَانٍ Or he stays away from, that the leader should stay away from, whatever he fears it will bring about harm, whether it be religious harm or whether it be worldly harm. The leader should stay away from things like that. Number two, فيه تألف قلوبهم بما لا يترك فيه أمر واجب. Number two is, whatever will bring the people's hearts close, to do it as long as it is بما لا يترك فيه أمر واجب. As long as you're not leaving on something that's obligatory. In the Sharia, we take into consideration what the people feel. As long as it's not the leaving and the abandonment of an obligatory command from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Number three, وفيه تقديم الأهم فالأهم من دفع المفسدة وجلب المصلحة وأنهما إذا تعارضا بدئ بدفع المفسدة. Number three is that you give precedence to the greatest thing in importance. So you prioritize things. How is it? By prioritizing here, فَالْأَهَمُّ مِنْ دَفْعِ الْمَفْسَدَةِ. The most important thing is to repel the evil. Which is more higher? Bringing about good or repelling evil? Which one is greater in the Sharia? The bringing about good or the pushing away of harm? Which one is? Pushing away harm is greater. Pushing away, the Prophet ﷺ wants to build the Kaaba. That's a maslaha. That's a good. But he has to get rid of the mafsada here, which is what? The people are going to? People are going to reject the religion. They're going to say, now Muhammad has gone to the Kaaba and he's destroying the Kaaba. He's what? He's destroying the Kaaba. Then in this situation, what happens? In this particular situation, we do the dar'ul mafsada, the repelling of the harm, then bringing about good. And this is very common because if you know a brother who's giving da'wah mathalan in front of a haram place, in a club, he goes to the club, he stands in front of it and he's saying to the people, you know, itaqullah, fear Allah. We'll say, what you're doing is bringing maslaha. Say, you're trying to bring good, you're trying to guide people from. But we're going to repel the harm first, which is what? You may fall, you might be a person who may fall into this club yourself tomorrow. And you might be a member of the security guards that are standing there. So dar'ul mafsada, repelling of the evil, takes precedence over what? Jalb al-maslaha. A person may say, for instance, I want to work with a deviated group. Now I'm going to work and share a platform with people who are misguided. And when he says that, he means, I'm going to bring about good. People are going to listen to me. And I'm going to convince them what they're doing is wrong. And at that slot of time, I'm going to guide a lot of people. We'll say, the repelling of evil takes precedence over the bringing about good. Which is, what about the people that you can make them, you can get to listen to him, to listen to them, and you becoming convinced with them, the repelling of evil takes precedence over what? Over bringing about good. A person is addicted to watching things that are haram. It comes from the telephone, it comes from gadgets that they use. Dar'ul mafsada awla min jalb al-maslaha. You get rid of these gadgets and these things. You don't use them. But you think, oh, sometimes I read Quran from it. Sometimes it reminds me that, you know, the Quran app reminds me it's Friday till I read Surah Al-Kahf. Etc. Dar'ul mafsadati awla min jalbil maslaha. You get rid of these things and you're not allowed to use it. That takes precedence over any good that you think is coming about with it. Point number four. We take from it. وفي أن المفسدة إذا أمن وقوعها عاد استحباب عمل المصلحة. Number four is that if we are safe from any harm coming, alhamdulillah, amina, we are safe from any harm coming or any harm taking place, then we go back to bringing about the good then. عاد استحباب عمل المصلحة. Once we know that the harm is not going to come, then now we can start thinking about bringing about good, he says, Ibn Hajar. Okay? Number five, وفي حديث الرجل مع أهله في الأمور العامة. Number five, is this hadith shows us the permissibility, okay, of a man talking to his family about what? General matters. As long as it's not backbiting or gossiping. General matters, a husband can talk to his wife and his spouse about it with them. General issues, the way that the Prophet was talking to Aisha. He wasn't specifying any individual. This is permissible. And it's allowed. And number six, وفيه حرص الصحابة على امتثال أوامر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this hadith, it also shows us how the companions would hasten and they would go fast in executing the Prophet's command. When the Prophet said, I will destroy the Kaaba, he knows who's going to do that. His companions. They're the ones who are going to straight to, as soon as he tells them, destroy the Kaaba, they're going to all go and do it. Because they are a people who followed him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And if you look at the Quran today, Allah says in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. In the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a what? لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ. It is in it for you guys. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. In the Messenger of Allah, أُسْوَةٌ. A role model, أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. A good role model. Pay attention here. Allah did not say there is a great role model in the Prophet's speech or in the Prophet's action or in the Prophet's etiquette or the Prophet's. Allah says there's a good role model in the Prophet himself. That means everything that comes from him is a role model for you. He's a role model in it for you, alayhi salatu wasalam. Sahih? It's in him. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. لَمْ يَقُلْ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى didn't say فِي أَفْعَالِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فِي أَقْوَالِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فِي تَصَرُّفَاتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. It said فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. In the messenger himself. Alayhi salatu wasalam. So you follow him in everything he did. Where if he spoke, you speak like he does. He does something, you do it. With the action and the intention, simultaneously. What do you follow him in? If he does something, you do it. How he did it and how what he intended from it. Does that make sense, brothers? He's a role model in everything. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam min adranil jahiliyyah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah saved him and protected him from the daran, the wasakh and the filth of jahiliyyah. Allah protected him from it, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he became a messenger, he was a person who lived hayatan fadilatan sharifatan, very honorable life, very virtuous life. He was never known, alayhi salatu wasalam, to have done things that were wrong, that went against etiquettes and morality. He wasn't known to do that. And the Prophet ﷺ was never accounted from any zalla and hafwa, shortcomings or errors. He wasn't. The Prophet ﷺ, all of his life, he was under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah protected him from what? Min aqdari al-jahiliyyah, the filth and the wrongdoings of the pre-Islamic individual, the pre-Islamic people and his people, what they were upon. The reason why Allah did all of that is to honor him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And to honor him with what? A message that's soon going to come. He's going to become a prophet of Allah. So he doesn't become a person who was known to be bad, and then now Allah guided him. He was always a what? A protected individual, alayhi salatu wasalam. If Quraysh was looked at, and the Arabs were looked at, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, from even amongst them, they themselves admitted, أَفْضَلُ قَوْمِهِ مُرُؤَةً, that he was the most honorable person in terms of morality, alayhi salatu wasalam. وَأَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا, in terms of etiquette, he was the best. وَأَكْرَمُهُمْ حَسَبًا, he was even the best in terms of lineage, alayhi salatu wasalam. He was a person who was great for what? وَأَعْظَمُهُمْ حِلْمًا, he was the greatest in terms of forbearance. وَأَصْدَقُهُمْ حَدِيثًا, he was the most truthful person, صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْهِ. وَأَعْظَمُهُمْ أَمَانَةً, he was the greatest person in terms of amana, what he was entrusted with. And he was far from وَأَبْعَدُهُ مِنَ الْفُحْشِ وَالْأَخْلَاقِ الَّتِي تُدَنِّسُ الرِّجَالِ, he was far from anything that could damage a man's dignity and reputation. He was far from it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Until he became well known in the midst of Quraysh, he became very well known to be what? Bil Amin, the truthful one, alayhi salatu wasalam. Hafidh ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he says in his kitab, in his tafsir, he says, ثم قال الله تعالى يعدد نعمه على عبده ورسوله محمد. الله حافظ ابن كثير رحمه. أخي الكريم, أخي don't go there. The sisters in there. الإمام حافظ ابن كثير رحمه الله تعالى, he said, ثم قال الله تعالى يعدد نعمه على عبده ورسوله محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. الله سبحانه وتعالى, he counted the blessings that he bestowed upon the Prophet ﷺ, all the blessings that he mentioned, he gave him. Allah states them, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And Allah says, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَأَوَى. Did Allah not bring you out to be an orphan and then care for you and take care of you? And that was, Ibn Kathir says, وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ أَبَاهُ تُوفِيَ. And that was because his father died. وَهُوَ حَمْلٌ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. And the Prophet was in the stomach of his mother whilst his father passed away. ثُمَّ تُوفِيَتْ أُمُّهُ آمِنَ بِنْتِ وَهْبٍ. And his mother died, آمِنَ بِنْتِ وَهْبٍ. وَلَهُ مِنَ الْعُمْرِ سِتُّ سِنِينَ. He was 6 years of age and his mother passed away. ثُمَّ كَانَ فِي كَفَالَةِ جَدِّهِ عَبْدِ الْمُطَلِبِ. And then he was under the protection of his what? His grandfather, عَبْدِ الْمُطَلِبِ. إِلَىٰ أَن تُوفِيَ. Until he died. وَلَهُ مِنَ الْعُمْرِ ثَمَانِ سِنِينَ. And he was only 8 years of age. فَكَفِلَهُ عَمُّهُ أَبُو طَالِبٍ. Then he got protected by and cared for by who? His uncle Abu Talib. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَزَلْ يَحُوطُهُ وَيَنْصُرُهُ وَيَرْفَعُ مِنْ قَدْرِهِ وَيُوَقِّرُهُ. Abu Talib remained protecting him, looking after him, giving victory to him, raising his status and venerating the Prophet. وَيَكُفُ عَنْهُ أَذَى قَوْمِهِ. And was protecting him from the harm of his people. بَعْدَ أَنِ ابْتَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى رَأْسِ 40 سَنَةً. Abu Talib was looking after him until he became a prophet sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the age of 40. من عمره. هذا وأبو طالب على دين قومه من عبادة الأوثان. And Abu Talib was upon the religion of his people in worshipping idols. وكل ذلك بقدر الله تعالى وحسن تدبيره. Ibn Kathir says, all of this took place with what? The ability of Allah تبارك وتعالى and Allah's well controlling of affairs. إلى أن توفي أبو طالب. Then Abu Talib passed away. قبل الهجرة بقليل. Just before the hijrah and the migration of the Prophet, a little bit before it. فأقدم عليه سفهاء قريش. Then the dim-witted individuals of Quraysh came forward. وجهالهم. And the ignorant ones. فاختار الله تعالى له الهجرة. Allah chose for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم a migration. من بين أظهرهم إلى بلد الأنصار من الأوس والخزرج. Allah تبارك وتعالى chose for the Prophet هجرة. From Quraysh to where? The land of Ansar. And Ansar were two main tribes. Who were they? Al-Awsi wal-Khazraji. Aws al-Khazraj. Kama ajra Allah ta'ala sunnatahu ala al-wajhi al-atami wal-akmari. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He destined, subhanahu wa ta'ala, His way in the greatest, in the completest way, Ibn Kathir says. Falamma wasala ilayhim awahu. And when the Prophet reached Medina, and he came to Ansar, they took care of him. وَنَصَرُوهُ وَحَاطُوهُ وَقَاتَلُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. They cared for him, they sheltered him, and they fought in front of him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. May Allah be pleased with all of them. وَكُلُّ هَذَا مِنْ حِفْظِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And all of this was a protection of Allah for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَكَلَاءَتِهِ وَعِنَايَتِهِ بِهِ. وَكَلَاءَتِهِ وَعِنَايَتِهِ بِهِ. And this was a form of Allah's protection for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Ibn Kathir says that all under the ayah, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Allah protected him until he died عليه الصلاة والسلام. So this is what? The ni'am of Allah تبارك وتعالى upon the Prophet. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he hated idol worshipping. بُغِضَ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم الأصنام. Allah made him hate idol worshipping. And the Prophet ﷺ نَشَأَ سَلِيمَ الْعَقِيدَةِ. He grew up and was nurtured upon a correct عَقِيدَةِ عليه الصلاة والسلام. The عَقِيدَةِ which was the fitrah. He was upon the fitrah عليه الصلاة والسلام. صادق الإيمان. Believed in Allah تبارك وتعالى. He didn't believe idol worshiping. He didn't like that. عميق التفكر. He was one who would think a lot عليه الصلاة والسلام. And he would ponder around him. غير خاضع لترهات الجاهلية. And he was not one that was known عليه الصلاة والسلام to humble himself from the wrongdoings of the pre-Islamic people, what they would do. فما عرف أنه, it was never known of him, أنه سجد لصنم قط. The Prophet was never known to have prostrated to an idol whatsoever. أو تمسح به, or that he touched and tried to find barakah from it. أو ذهب إلى عراف أو كاهن, or that he went to a fortune teller. Or a magician. بَلْ بُغِّضَ إِلَيْهِ عِبَادَةُ الْأَصْنَامِ. Rather, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hate in his heart. He hated idol worshipping. And Imam Ahmad narrates in his Musnad بِسَنَدٍ صَحِيحٍ عَنْ عُرْوَةِ بْنُ زُبَيْرٍ قَالَ حَدَّثَنِي جَارٌ لِخَدِيجَةِ بِنْتِ خُوَيْلِدٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهَا. Asha'al Imam Al-Allama Ahmad Shakir rahimahullah authenticates this story. And Shaykh Shu'ayb al-Arnaut also, that Urwat ibn Zubayr, he said, حَدَثَنِي جَارٌ لِخَدِيجَةِ بِنْتُ خُوَيْلِدٍ, a neighbor of Khadija, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, he told me, أَنَّهُ سَمِعَ النَّبِيَ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam وَهُوَ يَقُولُ لِخَدِيجَةَ, that he heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to Khadija, أي خديجة, أو خديجة, والله لا أعبد اللاتة, the Prophet was saying this to Khadija, والله لا أعبد اللاتة, I'm not going to worship Lat, والله لا أعبد العزة أبدا, والله I'm never going to worship عزة, عزة was an idol of Quraysh. قال فتقول خديجة, and Khadija was saying رضي الله عنها, خل اللاتة, leave off Lat, خل العزة, leave off عزة. ولما لقي, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he met بحير الراهب, the monk. قال له بحيرة, بحيرة said to him, أسألك باللات والعزة, I ask you by لات العزة, إلا أخبرتني عما أسألك عنه, that you're going to inform me of that which I'm asking you of. وكان بحيرة سمع قومه يحلفون بهما, بحيرة, he heard this Quraysh, when they used to come as traders, they would come to Damascus and they would say these statements, they were the ones who would say أسألك باللات والعزة, so he heard this from them. When he said that to the Prophet, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, لا تسألني بحق اللات والعزة شيئا, don't ask me anything in the affairs of اللات والعزة, فوالله ما أبغضت شيئا قط بغضي لهما, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I have not become angry whatsoever the way I have become angry with this issue of اللات والعزة. So the Prophet ﷺ was very well known for that. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i in his Sunan al-Kubra, the Mujtaba al-Kubra, Sunan al-Kubra, Nasa'i has two Sunans. One is Sughra and one is Kubra. Nasa'i mentions in his Sunan al-Kubra, بِسَنَدٍ قَوِيٍ, a sanad which is authentic. And Zayd ibn Harithah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that Zayd ibn Harithah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, كَانَ صَلَمَانِ مِنْ نُحَاسٍ, there were two idols that were made out of copper. يُقَالُ لَهُمَا إِسَافٌ, this idol was called Isafun. That was the name of the idol. Quraysh placed that idol around the Kaaba. So what they would do is they would go around it, and whenever they go around it, they would touch it in their tawaf. So the Prophet ﷺ, he done tawaf around the Kaaba, and Zayd ibn Harithata radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he did tawaf with the Prophet around the Kaaba. Zayd said, every time, فَلَمَّا مَرَرْتُ, whenever I went by these two idols, مَسَحْتُ بِهِ, I would touch it. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the Prophet said to Zayd, لَا تَمَسَّهُ, don't touch it. قَالَ زَيْدُ, then he said, فَطُفْنَا, we went around the Kaaba again. فَقُلْتُ فِي نَفْسِي, I said to myself, لَأَمَسَّنَّهُ, I would touch it, حَتَّى أَنْظُرَ مَا يَكُونُ, so I can see what will take place. فَمَسَحْتُهُ, I touched the idol. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the Prophet said to Zayd, لَا تَمَسَّهُ, don't touch it. أَلَمْ تُنْهَا, were you not prevented from it? Did I not stop you from it? Did I tell you not to do it? Zayd said, فَوَالَّذِي أَكْرَمَهُ, I swear by the Lord who honored Nabiullah Muhammad, وَأَنْزَلَ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابَ, and sent the book unto him, مَسْتَلَمَ صَلَمًا قَطْ, the Prophet never touched an idol, عليه الصلاة والسلام, حَتَّى أَكْرَمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى بِالَّذِي أَكْرَمَهُ, until Allah honored him with what he honored him with, which is that Allah honored him with Risala, Allah made him a messenger. وَأَنْزَلَ عَلَيْهِ, and Allah sent a revelation on him. وَبُغِضَ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الشِّعْرُ, the Prophet ﷺ also hated poetry. He hated it. عليه الصلاة والسلام. And it was never known that he, عليه الصلاة والسلام, أنه قال شعرا, that he said poetry from himself. أو أنشد قصيدة, or that he read a قصيدة, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Or that he even tried to do that. And the reason is because لأن ذلك يتلاءم مقام النبوة, this is in confliction with the station that Allah has given him, which is prophecy. And as you would know, is that the shu'ara, the pre-Islamic poets, they were not known for good etiquette. They were not bidawil akhlaq, people with good etiquette. And they didn't have a sirah al-mardiyya. If anybody reads, for example, Imru al-Qais, for example, from the Mu'allaqat, who's the first, between him and the Prophet ﷺ was what? 150 years. It is mu'allaqa. If you read it and you listen to why he said, "Kifa nabki min dhikra habibin wa manzilin bi siqti li'." If you read the story behind his poetry and why he says it, and what was the reason why he said it, they were alcoholics. They were people who were known for speaking bad. Their poetry consists of foul language. So this was not befitting for the biography of the Prophet ﷺ. Allah prevented him from this ﷺ. Allah gave him something even better, which is the Qur'an. He would not need to do something like that. Allah says in the Qur'an, وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ الشِّعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. Allah said, we have not taught him poetry, and it is not even befitted for him to be a poet. But even then, any poetry that had wisdom in it, that was calling to the truth, the Prophet ﷺ, يتذوق, he would enjoy listening to it. If it had good in it, and it had no bad statements in there, and if there was hikmah in there, and he would ask his companions if they could read some on him. Muslim narrated in his Sahih, عن الشريد بن سويد الثقفي رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, ردفت رسول الله, I rode on a riding beast with the Prophet on the back one day, and then he said to him, هل معك من شعر أمية بن أبي صلت, is it with you the poetry of أمية بن أبي صلت شيئا, do you have any of his poetry? There's a car blocking, inshallah ta'ala. It's FE02YHJ. FE02YHJ. And anyone whose car is blocking another car, it's from the akhlaq and it's the etiquette. Just move your car away from the people you're blocking. Mm-hmm. So the Prophet ﷺ said to the companion Shareed ibn Suwayd al-Thaqafi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Prophet said to him, هَلْ مَعَكَ مِنْ شَعْرِ أُمَيَّةِ إِبْنُ أَبِي صَلْتِ, do you have any of his poetry with you? قَالَ قُلْتُ نَعَمْ, he said, I said, yes, there is. The Prophet then said to him, he, meaning, okay, read it on us. فَأَنْشَدْتُهُ بَيْتًا, I read on him a couplet. A bait is only one line with the two shatr. I read it on him. فَقَالَ, he then said to me, the Prophet said to him, he, meaning how you read it, carry on reading it. ثُمَّ أَنْشَدْتُ بَيْتًا, I added one extra line on it for him. فَقَالَ, he then says to me, عليه الصلاة والسلام, said to him, he said, I carried reading it. حَتَّى أَنْشَدْتُ مِئَةَ بَيْتٍ, until I read 100 lines on for him. And Imam al-Nawawi, he says in Sharh Sahih Muslim, وَمَقْصُودُ الْحَدِيثِ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِسْتَحْسَنَ شِعْرَ أُمَيَّةَ وَاسْتَزَادَ مِنْ إِنْشَادِهِ لما فيه من الإقرار بالوحدانية والبعث, ففيه جواز إنشاد الشعر الذي لا فحش فيه وسماعه سواء شعر الجاهلية وغيرهم, وأن المذموم من الشعر الذي لا فحش فيه إنما هو الإكثار منه وكونه غالبا على الإنسان, فأما يسيره فلا بأس بإنشاده وسماعه وحفظه. الإمام النووي رحمه الله says here, the intent of the hadith is that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he enjoyed and he liked the shi'r of Umayyah ibn Abi Salt. And he requested for it to be added on for him. Like he requested, was tazada min inshadi. He said, okay, say more for me. Why? Lima fihi min al-iqrari bil wahdaniyya. Because in it was what? The affirmation of Allah's oneness. Allah's oneness in ibadah. Wal ba'thi. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to resurrect the slaves. Fafihi jawazu inshadi shi'ri. And he said, Nawawi said that this shows that the permissibility of saying poetry, الَّذِي لَا فُحْشَ فِيهِ, that which does not hold in it foul language, وَسَمَعُهُ, and that you can also listen to it if you want to, سَوَاءٌ شِعْرُ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ, whether it be pre-Islamic poetry or if it's other than that, وَأَنَّ الْمَذْمُومَ مِنَ الشِّعْرِ, and the thing that is disliked and blameworthy about poetry is الَّذِي لَا فُحْشَ فِيهِ, the poetry that doesn't have bad in it, the ones that are disliked and blameworthy is إِنَّمَا هُوَ الْإِكْتَارُ مِنُهُ, when the person makes it his whole life poetry. وَكَوْنُهُ غَالِبًا عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ, and also when the person makes this something that they are the majority of their situation. فَأَمَّا يَسِيرُهُ Now he says, if this is little, فَلَا بَأْسَ بِإِشْهَادِهِ The person is not a problem if he sometimes reads it, and he says it. وَسَمَاعِهِ And also what? If the person listens to it. وَحِفْظِهِ And even if the person memorizes it. He memorizes it. But there's a qadiyah I have to point out here, which is a mas'ala, which is very important. Nowadays, the qadiyah that people speak about, which is anashid al-islamiyah, they call it. The ulama of this time, the great scholars, Shaykh Abdulaziz bin Baz, Shaykh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen and others, and Shaykh Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad and others, they all said it's not permissible. And there's a risala qayyima, a very good risala, written by a noble shaykh, his name is Shaykh Abdul Salam Burgess, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, who died at a very young age. But he wrote a risala, very good, where he talks about wasailu da'wa, is it tawqifiyya or is it not? And he talks about this issue of anashid islamiyya. Can a person make that a form of da'wah or what not? And all of his mu'allafat, his tahqiqat and his mu'allafat are all being published. It's all what? It's published. So one needs to stay away from that. Let alone the fact that it's been called anashid islamiyya. It becomes an innovation now. It becomes a what? Innovation. And it enters the hadith of the Prophet, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فهو رد وفي رواية من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد انتزد ومع هذا with all of that said فقد كان صلى الله عليه وسلم يتذوق ما في الشعر من جمال the prophet would enjoy if the poetry had good in it if it had wisdom in it and if it had حكمة in there and ورع and he would sometimes ask his companions to say it as we just saw because he said عليه الصلاة والسلام إن من البيان لسحرا In eloquency, there is magic, eloquency. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الشِّعْرِ حِكْمَةِ And from some lines of poetry is what? Some shi'r have wisdom in it. And it was Hassan ibn Thabitin, رضي الله تعالى عنه, that the Prophet would say to أُهُجُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ Go and attack the disbelievers, the pagans. فَإِنَّ جِبْرِيلَ مَعَكَ Jibreel is with you. And some riwayat says, Ruh al-Qudus, meaning Jibreel is with you. Hassan ibn Thabit ibn al-Mundhir al-Ansari, he was from the Khazraj tribe of Ansar. And he was a person who defended Sha'ir al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the Prophet's poet. And they said, Hassan ibn Thabit, he lived 60 years before Islam, and he lived 60 years what? Whilst in Islam. So he lived for how many years? 100 and... He became very old. And he died at the Khilafah of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu ta'ala anhum sanata 54 min al-Hijrah. When it was the year 54 Hijriyah. As Hafidh ibn Hajar mentions in his Kitab al-Isabah fi Tamiz al-Sahaba. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, he never drank khamr. وَلَا قَرُوبَ مِنْ فَاحِشَةٍ And he never came close and was never made to come close to any fahisha alayhi salatu wasalam inshallah ta'ala we'll stop there for today anything which I said that was wrong or incorrect is from me shaytan and Allah and his messenger are free from it subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk